Okay, next we'll see that composition of the urine. Means what are the things they are going to be present in a urine. Actually, urine, it is a light yellow in a color. Okay, we are also going to call as a, you know, amber color. Amber color, that is nothing but the color of hay, that is nothing but dried grass. Okay, and especially light yellow in color, that is nothing but what, transparent fluid. Urine is nothing but a transparent fluid. It is a it is containing that light yellow in color due to the presence of one pigment, that is nothing but urochrome. Okay, whatever the pigment which is present in a urine, it is called as a urochrome. Due to the presence of that urochrome, okay, and urine is going to be present light yellow or amber in color. Okay, and it is one what, transparent fluid. Okay, and when we are going to take more amount of water, as it easily, you know, more amount of urine is going to be excreted. And already we know that per day nearly 1.62, you know, 1.8 liters of urine we are going to excrete per day there. Okay, that is what quantity of the urine we are going to excrete per day. That is nearly 1.62, 1.8 liters of urine we are going to excrete per day. And whatever the formation of urine and excretion of urine, it is going to be depends on the fluids what we are going to intake. Okay, and based on that the quantity of urine, it is going to be depends there. And next here, what is the composition, means what are the things they are going to be present within that urine there. And mainly we may see that maximum amount of water is going to be present, that is nearly 96% of water it is going to be present in a urine. And remaining within that 4% there, 2.5% of organic substances they are present, and remaining 1.5%, you know, inorganic substances they are going to be present there. And especially in urine, mainly the major amount, that is nothing but water. 96% of water is going to be present, and 2.5% of organic substances. Then what are the organic substances, what type of organic substances they are present within that urine? That is nothing but, and urea is going to be present, uric acid, creatine, creatinine, water soluble vitamins, and as well as a few hormones, you know, and as well as oxalates, they are going to be present within that urine there. And all they are considered as organic substances. And nearly 2.5% of organic substances they are present in that urine there. And next remaining 1.5% of inorganic substances they are going to be present in the urine there. And sodium, chlorine, you know, and as well as phosphate ions, sulfate ions, and next we have what, magnesium, and as well as calcium, iodine, all these they may come under inorganic substances of urine there. Okay, and especially the pH of the urine, that is a 6. Already we know that 6, it is nothing but acidic in nature. Urine, it is a, the pH of the urine, that is a 6, nearly 6 there. 6 is nothing but it contains acidic nature, isn't it? pH 6, it is nothing but acidic in nature. But at the beginning, it is acidic. But, and when the deamination there, okay, deamination of what, urea. As a result of deamination of urea, you know, ammonia is going to be formed. And when ammonia is going to be formed, it will be converted into alkaline in a nature. Okay, and especially the pH of urine, starting it will be acidic, that is nothing but 6, because of pH 6 there, it is a what, acidic in nature. And when the deamination is going to be takes place, that is nothing but when the urea is going to be converted into ammonia there, automatically what, it will be converted into alkaline in a nature. When the two kidneys are going to be filled, automatically, you know, the filtration of blood, it is not going to be takes place, because already you know that the filtration unit is nothing but a nephron which is present in the kidney. And when these two kidneys are going to be failed functionally, automatically the filtration of blood, it is not going to be takes place. As a result, definitely what, the unwanted waste and water is going to be stored within our body. As a result, our hands and as well as our legs, they may swell. And this type of condition, it is called as a uremia. And also we are having ESRD, that is nothing but end stage renal disease. And what is end stage renal disease? The end stage renal disease, it is nothing but the complete and irreversible damage or failure of both kidneys there. It is called as a end stage renal disease. That is nothing but the two kidneys, they are unable to work properly. As a result, our body, it is going to be fulfilled with unwanted poisonous waste there. Okay, and this condition is called as a ESRD. That is nothing but a end stage renal disease there. And to overcome this problem, we have one thing, that is nothing but what, dialysis there. Okay, the process, it is called as a dialysis. And especially, you know, it is going to be considered as a artificial kidney, because and whatever the work, it is going to be takes place within the kidney, that filtration process, it is going to be takes place within this dialysis machine. Because of that, we are considering this process as a artificial kidney there. And especially within this dialysis, and we may observe one instrument there, okay. And especially the main, whatever the patient there, okay, especially from the body of that patient, from main artery, you know, the blood is going to be supplied to the what, dialyzing machine there, okay. And when it is going to be entered, whatever, through the main artery to the dialyzing machine, when the blood is going to be transferred, before that, anticoagulant, that is nothing but heparin, is going to be added to the blood from the main artery to the what, dialyzing machine there. And within that dialyzing machine, we may observe one fluid. It is called as a dialyzing fluid or a dialyzer fluid there. And what is the importance of that dialyzing fluid or dialyzer fluid? Means it is going to contain the same composition of the plasma. It is going to be contains the same composition of the plasma, except nitrogenous waste there. Means nitrogenous waste, they are going to be absent within that dialyzing fluid. But whatever the plasma which is present in the blood, which is coming into this dialyzing machine there, dialyzer machine there, especially whatever the blood, it is going to contain the nitrogenous waste there. But whatever this dialyzer fluid or dialyzing fluid, it is containing the same composition of the plasma which is present within that what, dialyzing machine there, okay. Means whatever the blood which is coming out from our the patient's body, and that blood, especially it contains plasma, the composition of the plasma, it will be equal with the composition of the fluid which is present in that dialysis machine there. Except what, nitrogenous waste are going to be absent within that dialyzer fluid. And next, what is going to be present, what is going to be happen, means whatever the nitrogenous waste, they are present in the blood, they are going to be transmitted to the dialyzer fluid. And especially by the process of osmosis there, and through the membranes of that embedded tubes there, whatever the blood which is transferring within that embedded tubes, the nitrogenous waste, they are entering into the dialyzing fluid. As a result, whatever the blood floating in that whatever the blood flowing within that embedded tubes there, automatically that nitrogenous waste, they are going to be removed from that blood. As a result, blood is going to be filtered. And same work which is going to be takes place within that glomerulus, same that work is going to be takes place within this dialyzing machine there. That is nothing but dialysis. We are sending that blood into that machine. As a result, it is called as a hemodialysis here, okay. And to complete one dialysis session there, nearly it is going to takes place 3 to 6 hours of time there. To complete one dialysis session, nearly it is going to takes place 3 to 6 hours of time there. And also we are relating there blood coagulation, okay. And for the purpose of blood coagulation, nearly 3 to 6 minutes of time it is going to takes place here. 3 to 6 hours of time to complete one dialysis session, and here 3 to 6 minutes of time it is going to be takes place to clot the blood. That is nothing but for the blood coagulation there, okay. And they are correlated here, 3 to 6 hours of time and 3 to 6 minutes of time here, okay. And next here, when the two kidneys, they are going to be failed, we went for dialysis. Here dialysis, it is a temporary solution for the filtration of the blood. Then what is the permanent solution for the filtration of blood within that patients? Nothing but ESRD patients or uremic patients there. Nothing but here the permanent solution for the uremic patients or ESRD patients there, especially you know kidney transplantation there. Okay, and the first kidney transplantation operation was done successfully by the doctor Charles Hofnagel in Washington of America, and especially in the year of 1954 there. In that 1954, the first successful kidney transplantation operation was done between two identical twins by Dr. Charles Hofnagel in America. And next, within our India, the first kidney transplantation operation here, it is done in the year 1971 there, and especially on December 1st, it is done in a Christian Medical College in Vellore. It is located in the state of Tamil Nadu. Okay, and this is regarding the kidney transplantation. And next, we have axillary excretory organs along with the kidney. And we have lot of axillary, nothing but additional excretory organs. They are nothing but especially you know we are having liver and as well as lungs and as well as liver, lungs, skin. Okay, all these things you know they are going to be enacted as axillary excretory organs. For example, just you take lungs there, and lungs, what is going to be happen? And especially carbon dioxide is going to be excreted out. That is nothing but carbon dioxide, also one type of waste there, and it is going to be excreted out. It will be sent out with the help of lungs. Because of that, you know, lungs, it is considered as a accessory excretory organ there. And even though you know there we have you know especially our tears there, and even though through the tears also some amount of nitrogenous waste they are going to be excreted out there. And you know with the help of the tears, okay, and whatever the glands which are present in our eyes especially, and they are releasing one type of fluid, that is nothing but tears we may call as, okay, and through the tears also some amount of nitrogenous waste they are going to be excreted out there. And next we have you know different organisms, they are going to contain different type of excretory organs. For example, human beings, you know, they are going to consider or they are going to contain kidneys as their excretory organs, and remaining organisms there, they are having their own excretory organs. Now we will see here, and especially protozoans there, the primary organisms, and the protozoans, you know, simply how they are going to excrete the waste material from their body, nothing but through the simple diffusion method. Simple diffusion method, the waste materials are going to be excreted out from the body surface. And next we have you know porifera and cylinderates there. Okay, within that poriferans and as well as in cylinderates, and through the water baths, the waste materials are going to be excreted out. And next we have platyhelminths there. Okay, and especially you know the platyhelminths, they are going to contain the special cells as their excretory organs. They are nothing but phloem cells there. Example, planaria. In that planaria, we may observe the phloem cells as a excretory organ there. And next we have nematoda or nematihelminths there. Okay, within that nematodes, we have rennet cells as a excretory organs there. And next we have annelida, and within that annelids, nephridia, you know, nephridia are considered as a excretory organs. And next we have arthropoda, you know, the biggest phylum, okay, the biggest phylum, that is nothing but arthropoda there. And especially within that arthropoda, we may observe you know different insects, especially you know maximum insects, they are placed in that arthropoda, and different organisms within that arthropoda, they are going to contain different type of excretory organs, like green glands and as well as malvesian tubules and as well as coxal glands, etc. Like this you know different type of excretory organs they may present within that phylum, that is nothing but in arthropoda. And next we have molluscans or mollusks. Within that molluscans, especially metanephridia, you know, metanephridia, they are considered as a excretory organs there. And next we have echinodermates there, okay, echinodermates. And within that echinodermates, and they are going to contain one special system to expose, to excrete the waste outside, you know, it is called as a water vascular system there, okay. With the help of that water vascular system, the waste substances, they are going to be excreted out from the body of that what echinodermates there. And next we have, you know, reptiles and as well as birds, nothing but aves, and as well as in mammals, you know, the major excretory organs, they are nothing but kidneys there.